Margot Rudell, and these are poems about Argentine tango. Yeah. Universal truth. Dancing with a tango superstar from Buenos Aires, I remembered something important. He is a man, and I a woman. Tango feeling. How does tango feel? It's indescribable, he replied, his eyes for the first time meeting mine. Ecstasy. Filling me with ecstasy. All it takes is one dance, tango, with the right music and man. A smile I can't hide betrays how I feel inside. Most satisfying. Tango is a lover, unlike any other, absolutely satisfying every time. Tango bliss. A smile, a joy, a passion takes over my body, my expression. I begin to glow when I find a tantalizing partner in tango. Tango feeling. Luscious pleasure, almost sinful, thoroughly captivating, totally satisfying. A tango set. A conversation between two strangers in which your whole body and mind form your voice and path to communication before you know each other's names. Telltale tips. Copper penny covered or bright purple shoes tell you that I'm ready to dance tango with you. You can tell I know how from the brand I wear, and that here and now I'm ready to play, and that you'll remember me somehow, comme il faut, the telltale sign of an advanced dancer of Argentine tango. Improvisational tango. When a man feels free with his partner as his instrument to create a new symphony of movement and inspiration. Mismatched partners. Two tango dancers in close embrace, each looking opposite directions. A smile creeps across his face. He looks excited and aroused. Her face shows boredom and confinement. He doesn't know, neither does she. Their stark contrast, only the crowd sitting and watching can see. Bye bye Casanova. An Argentine tango Casanova tried to tempt me to indiscretion by telling me others warned him to steer clear of me, a heartbreaking and difficult beauty. He hoped his ruse would land me in his bed. He was mistaken, as many others before him had been. I left happily solo. He had to find another ride home.
All right.
Butterfly smiles. A professional tango dancer made my night with these words tonight. It is my pleasure. You are an excellent, excellent dancer. You are like a butterfly. Faithful. Tango is more faithful than any relationship. It's always there for me. Tango love. Tango makes love to me sensually, fulfilling me totally, clothed. In 3-minute increments, passion starts, the music grips my heart. Argentine dancer. An exotic stranger, a man with long hair pulled back in a ponytail. He's too confident to be American. He must be Argentine. You can tell by the wild in his eyes. Compulsion. The night brings new energy to me, and all those called to dance tango, like those who must howl at the moon.
Thank you so much. Jane, then Bill, then
Lewis, come on up, Jane. She hasn't been here in a while, so warm it up. She's set up.
Yay!
I have two poems. Spirit boats. I was in a spirit boat that floated on a spirit sea, airy waves, no foam. I floated in a spirit boat, so light it rose above the waves. I made no waves, no fussing, no shushing. I left my spirit there when I disembarked to live among the trees. I have friends here, on the branches, among the leaves. I sit in a bird's nest. I live with a winged spirit in the nest, on a limb, in a tree near the water. I can see the boat out there now, and it's going under, empty. Understanding the world. In the mandala, heavy bars divide and beget. Macro, the rain and the snow, the dirt and the rainbow. Micro, all forces and fields, magnetic and otherwise. Traces of other life forms and spirit and touch. Thanks. I just want to mention, I'll be reading with Stephen Capel and Nancy Wakeman and Al Averbach at Hardin Studios July 26th, and that's at 2140 Bush. I'll leave the flyer here. Thanks.
Thank you so much. Bill, the bluest, and Stephanie, the Marsha. Bring up Bill, please.
Bill, sir. A couple of years ago, the physicist in Switzerland isolated what they call the God particle, which is ridiculous, but they isolated the Higgins bogs. Boson. That this particle was the beginning of the universe, which just, you know. But anyway, so this is kind of in that line. What opened the door? What was it before the Big Bang, this great koan of the universe? It came from nothing equals. It came from something. It was not a speck in space because all space was folded within. It was not a possibility in time because all time was coiled within. What was it? The telescopes close their briefcases and look for a different line of work. The computers break down into psychotic cannibals with a taste for silicon flesh. The physicist bleeds quantums and strings and theorems into his deathbed. The philosopher walks a tightrope tied to the end of a dead-end street, then boils his eyeglasses for lunch. The theologian speaks with a mouth full of apples and alligators. The Zen master sits beneath a stop sign and winks with one glass eye. What was it, this thing or no thing, beyond the end of human reach? This naked singularity to the trillionth power, this perfect unity of time and mass and space and energy. What was it? And why would such a perfection explode into this messy stew of matter and time and energy and space? Weak force, dark energy, dark matter, strings, quantums, black holes, galaxies, and supernovas. Was it something like a boredom with perfection? A need for the singular to be expressed in the multiple? The loneliness of the one? What was it? And what opened the door?
physics, you know? All right. Louis, Stephanie, then Marcia. So Louis, come on up, and then Stephanie, then Marcia. Give them a round, please.
No physics here, I guarantee it.
Hey, it's good to have you back.
Thank you very much, Rich. This is called I Am. I am the death, the dull hull of the sunken ship, old bones bumping on the bottom. I am consciousness too raw and unnerving, conscious consternation, fabrication of fornication. How dare you, he asks. Well, I fought the bitch too, I reply. I am alive, the burning fire of desire, the bare white knuckles that strive to deprive. And I am the piss, the pus, the poison of the long straight arrow of hate aimed right at your eye. While seeking forgiveness of sin, I condemn the innocent to death. While drunk on wine and reeling, I set the guilty free. Ha! I am the epitome of hypocrisy, unapologetic. I am light, luminous, speech voluminous, and meaning totally devoid. Sorry. My daughter always says to say when the poem a terminé, and I didn't do that. It's not that. So, okay. I am the final flicker of the lamp that cracked, damp, dumb, numb. One moment I am aglow, eyes blazing, the next dead, eyes glazing. I am the phoenix unable to rise from the ashes, the penis, Venus, now limp and lazy after prolonged longing and lust. The little clitoris that can't, sensitive to Romeo's fumbling fingers, the nipples gone flat and soft as jelly on their fleshy mountain tops. I am the rust on the old sword, the bloody rags of rage and war. I am what is, what was, what will be. I am the past tense of the present tense of the past, the future canceled, and the dangling participle of what might have been. But don't expect a refund, dude. Your life is as pointless as mine. It wouldn't make a difference. I am nothing at all. Spot on the wall, the spit in the hall that is seen when you look in my direction, because I am no longer there. I am contradiction, the current rendition of all things trivial, a limited edition of small truths and big lies. I am merely everyone you meet these days. Okay, my daughter said, don't read it, it's not very nice, but this is sad at least, so Sam's good sometimes. Called Isla Vista Dirge. After Sandy Hook, I thought things might get better. Wasn't 20 dead little ones enough for you, Mr. Death? Love me, me, love me, love me. Mi, re, mi, fa, so, fa, mi, re, do, re, mi, re, do, re, mi, fa, so, fa, mi, re, mi. Then the next rampage began, six down in the teary town of Isla Vista, Isla Trista. La, mi, mi, la, mi, la, mi, la, mi. Americans are an exceptional people, we are told. If you're lucky, you will never meet one of these exceptional people and live a long life. She had a bright smile and an impish grin. She was what they used to call a live wire, bygone times before the devolution of culture began. Then she became leaky and lame in the grass, silent and still, her smile ascended in the starry night sky. La mi mi, la mi, la mi mi, la. The young man who turned off her juice, so full of ideas, and such a good shot at close range, truly remarkable among the mental low writers of our time and an American classic of self-inflicted mental disorder. Let us sing the recessional for mass murder. We know it well now. In a country and a culture where reason and politicians retreat like cowards to the vestibules, exchanging nods and money, and the rings of power are in all the wrong hands. Mi, re, di, do, di, do, do, re, do, re, mi. It's only a little bit longer, so if you can stand this, it's less bad than a gunshot wound to the head. Then let us turn the page that should never have been written in the book of the dead and weep for lost dreams and broken lives. Mi, re, mi, fa, sol, re, mi. Retribution, young man, retribution. Are you now even with people who did not know you and never harmed you, who would probably have helped you had you had they known your pain, fame, infamy, foul fiend, flipper the gibbet of the internet age, internet rage, jealous of friendship and female favor. How dare you? May your long, gloomy face descend into dark matter, banned forever from this world. La mi, la mi, la mi, la mi. Behold the blighted landscape, one bad idea heaped on top of another in the American junkyard of the mind.
Members of our upstanding community, which is now sitting down.
How are you, Stephanie?
I just want to read, I'll just read a little bit from this article in the paper today. Yeah, which is from the Washington Post by Ruben Navarrete about the 50,000 young people that are being detained. And he says, I thought it was very poetically and well worded. So anyway, here's a couple of little phrases from it. The lost children of Central America are now doubly lost in the fog of debate over what should become of them. Americans started off talking about the children, but quickly meandered into distracting conversations about politics, blame, history, ideology, and government funding. And predictably, the border children have been dragged into the immigration debate. That is maddening. These children are not immigrants. It's not as if they came over here to take paper routes that American youths wouldn't take. These are refugees who came here for a haven because they thought Americans would offer it. As we know, cowardice is a bipartisan affliction. It's ghastly how fast the process is moving. Can Obama administration officials at least pretend that they understand the stakes involved and that we're getting ready to hand death sentences to 10-year-old kids? And this in a country where lawmakers passed legislation to protect children from head-on collisions and sugary drinks, where we might convene a congressional subcommittee to investigate the dangers of peanut butter. How did we get so far off track? Sitting atop a high cliff past land's end, the overwhelming ocean roars against the land. It washes roughly over sea lions basking on the rocks. So much water, so far down this cliffside. Fragile life, how I cling to you like a lover, lucky to have you even just for the moment on this day, ocean widening at the horizon.
Okay, we have Marcia, then Ann, then Tom, then Owen, then Marcin. Oh my God, I'm in there. You better watch out. So give Marcia a round. She hasn't been here in a while.
Fell down.
Irish Mexican. Marble purple Irish Mexican secrets lost has vanished. Ashes and dust and ivory and the red oleander of a child's dream. Braille wife is the ultimate driving machine. Mind your leave taking, she cried. But he was a blind man, he said. All you do is cry and complain. Lois and I made leaves out of white oleanders and pink and found out the leaves were poison to horses in Phoenix in 56, where my mother was left alone. No, you can't even feed these horses grass, said the old cowboy. It's been sprayed. While I headed north to Oregon to visit my real dad for a month, Blind John went to a business conference in Illinois, and my mother was alone for 3 weeks more than any woman had ever been. We wanted to be horses raced around the track. I answered the long distance call, please. Don't make me come home. I don't want to fight anymore. Thank you. This poem is for my friend George Wynn, the guy who knows 5 languages and sells street spirit on the streets of Oakland and writes for them. He's published more than 250 poems in the Street Spirit magazine, or newspaper, I should say. Poem for George Wynn. Here in San Francisco, 68 degrees in January, it started to rain lightly. In Blue Oregon, it had been hard to walk uphill against the pouring rain. Now we are at Barnes & Noble of SF. Go get shining books on Oregon. I will sit still as I can, sip my hot chocolate, and wait for you slowly, and wist for you till my cup is empty. And you return full of books on politics, philosophy, poems, and those others shouting, cerulean skies, vital as summer in my hometown. Thank you.
So there's a couple of people who came in, and I know that you're concerned about signing in, but the first half is already done, so when after the feature reads, then you can come in and sign in, because you won't be able to sign in before the feature, because all those spots are taken. So just thought I'd be clear about that, because I didn't have a chance to say that before. But now, Ann Leonard, will you kindly step forward?
Hey.
Hi, I'm at the end of the chapter, In the Fault Zone, the Punk Crunch on SF Socio-Politico Distortion, which is SF Punk and Industrial, 76 to 81. So let's see, the last paragraph, we were speculating that Biafra had lost his cherry on our sofa. Pretty sure. Okay, next one is Joe Reese's Target Video had recorded hundreds of punk bands, both live and in their studio, showing the footage at various clubs in New York, Boston, Washington, D.C., Los Angeles, and also in Europe. After a fire had devastated their Oakland warehouse, the studios moved to South Van Ness in San Francisco. Joe had been opening the space as an after-hours hangout for a few months when the police started coming by with noise complaints. The night he threw a party for the English band Madness was low-key, with only a few dozen guests there. But the studio was busted by police nonetheless. They badly beat Sam Edwards, an easygoing Target staffer, and carted Joe and 14 others off to jail, charging them with offenses ranging from conspiracy to selling beer without a license. It took a while, but most of the charges were dropped later on. It was getting to be hard to be a punk and not anywhere near as much fun. By the end of 1979, the harassment and negative media attention was having its effect, and we had the feeling that punk was dead. After our collective decision to stop publishing Search and Destroy, Vale and Ruby moved to Romolo Place and eventually launched Research, a new magazine dedicated to exploring even more esoteric aspects of art and culture, pumping fresh blood and ideas into the sickly scene. Vale had been in touch with Rough Trade, England's number one independent record company, and when they started business in the States, they decided to make San Francisco their base of operations. The collectively run company opened a retail store and distribution center on Upper Grant, and also, this was about 1979, I think, the early issues of Research. They started out recording Cabaret Voltaire and Stiff Little Fingers, following up with the pop group, the Raincoats, Kleenex from Switzerland, and the Slits. We loved their lineup of bands and played Cabaret Voltaire and the Slits over and over again. Soon after their move to the States, the company signed Pere Ubu, the Fall and Joy Division, put out a compilation album. Peter Walmsley and Alan Sturdy had come from London to run things, and Vale and Ruby worked at the store, where they added the personal touch of playing records for customers who wanted to hear something new. Rough Trade had begun to fill the void for music fans with their extensive inventory of hard-to-find reggae imports and industrial music, and with an outpost in San Francisco, the innovative labels, English bands, including the Young Marble Giants, the Slits, Cabaret Voltaire, and Throbbing Gristle, who wouldn't have made it otherwise, were able to come to town and perform. One afternoon, I'd run into Raymond Foy, who was sitting on a bench in Washington Square Park. He'd interviewed Burroughs for the next-to-last issue of Search and Destroy, and as a young editor had brought visionary beat poet Bob Kaufman's work back into print. His deep belief in Kaufman's work had convinced the poet to publish The Ancient Rain, 1956 to 1978, after a 14-year hiatus. Sitting on the bench, he was immersed in the pages of what turned out to be an obscure printing of a long piece written by Gregory Corso. He let me read it, exclaiming over and over again, "He's the best on the planet, the best on the planet." I noticed Gregory Corso and his wife wheeling their baby Max around the busy square, and Vale had told me they were moving back and forth between San Francisco and New York for 6 months at a time. One day I was walking past a Bohemian cigar store across from the square, and Corso stopped me. He wanted to know about my punk garb, the "what's the little gun for on your lapel" sort of thing, but quickly moved from apparel to sex, asking, "Do you want to fuck?" When I said no, he went on a friendly tangent, wondering, "What's the matter with women these days? It used to be, you met someone at a party, you asked if they wanted to fuck, and boom, you had sex right there in the hallway against the wall. Nowadays, nothing's happening." Then he said, "Hey, let me see your breasts." Since I was wearing an oversized men's dress shirt, too, I unbuttoned my suit coat so he could get a better idea. "Gee, they're kind of small," he said. "Let's go to Walgreens. It's almost Valentine's Day, and I have to steal my wife a box of chocolate. She likes the big heart-shaped ones." So we headed across the street, where I stuffed some antacid in my pocket while he zipped the largest red cellophane heart on display inside his bomber jacket, leaving a huge Valentine's Day bulge across his chest. I couldn't figure out how the drugstore stayed in business, because no one I knew ever paid for a thing at the Chinatown Walgreens we always shoplifted. Late in 1980, when William Burroughs came to the city for a fantastic performance of Readings and Music, Mark McLeod gave a party for the writer at his Mission District Warehouse Studio to celebrate. Tattoo artist Ed Hardy and... And underground cartoonist provocateur Paul Mavridis were there, along with many well-known punks. Adding more excitement to the evening, some of the Beats were also in attendance, including the scene-making Allen Ginsberg, whom I caught in front of the Mavahai one evening waiting for the doors to open. The industrial performance group Rhythm and Noise played on stage. Mark had constructed at one end of the studio, where afterwards a throne-like chair was placed for Burroughs to preside from while he chatted with people. We've been drinking for a while, and Vale introduced Ruby to the god of our pantheon, and she made a major faux pas with her statement, "You've been an incredible inspiration to me, even though you probably hate women." "I don't hate women," came the gravelly response from Burroughs, as a horrified-looking Vale quickly pulled the writer away. Then he gave the rest of us girls strict orders not to talk to the man. Later, old Bull Lee showed what a good sport he was and let Ruby do a photo shoot with him, with one of the series featuring holding a pump-action shotgun rumored to be Tim Leary's favorite portrait of the man.
I'm waiting for the movie. I'm waiting for the movie. All right. Thank you so much. All right. Tom Holmberg, Owen Dunkel, myself, then Martin Joseph, then our feature Clara Sue. So, Tom, come on up, my friend. Give these people one more. Four. Four, five.
Hi there. I'm Tom Holmberg, and I'm happy to be with you again, and thank you for your
inspiration.
I always forget that last part. Everybody always reminds me. Thanks a lot. Okay, I'm gonna read you a poem that I do not like. It's a short one, and I like short poems.
You know. That you don't like?
Yeah, but I don't like this one. It's called Confusion. I don't like confusion, I just hate it. Okay, confusion is so easy to get, people do not pay for it. Does anybody like that? Why in the world? Okay.
I've been
there. Let's try. It's called, I hadn't written anything new in a while. That made me think of Sir Francis Bacon and E.E. Cummings and it and St. Vincent Millay. Isn't it funny? So, and then I thought, well, hell, I'll write something new, and here it is. And it's called Nothing New. What's new? Well, I'm pretty sure there is nothing new under the sun or anywhere else, really. Anywhere else in the universe, really. Just differently arranged material of the same stuff. Oh, there are things we do not know, but it is not new. Okay, what is differently arranged then? Oh, dot, 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 dot. That might be impressionistic or something. Sir Francis Bacon. He wrote a short poem called Something or Other. And it said, leave a kiss but in the cup and I'll not look for wine. I really like that. It's one of my favorites. So one time I went over to this old girlfriend's house and she said, hello. Would you like a glass of wine? And I said, sure. And she brought me back an empty glass. It was empty. And I said, oh, where's the wine? And she got really mad. And she said, didn't you see the lipstick on the glass? And I said, oh. And another thing, I thought you said you were going to bring over a bottle of wine for dinner.
Oh, dang it.
Wasn't that a bad evening?
You're in the doghouse.
Yeah. But, you can sure get confused when you're in a relationship sometime. You don't even want to pay for it. A bowl of cherries can taste pretty good if you like them. Intimacy. I have actually heard of people who share their passwords. That's serious intimacy, I think. Not all toilets are bathrooms. So,
that it?
Boy, am I slow, huh? Okay, here's that last one. It's really long. When I close my eyes, I can still see you.
Yeah.
Did you hear that?
Yeah.
No. The last line again, please.
When I close my eyes, I can still see you.
Yeah. The vision of loving is true. Thank you. Okay, so Owen Dunkel, myself, Martin Joseph, and Clara Sue, then Ogden Nash, and William Jennings Bryan. They're going to do a terpsichorial performance before your very eyes tonight, and they're in the back rehearsing. Owen, come on up. Give him a nice round, please.
Shout it out, Owen. Shout it out.
Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
At the beach, the brown and white speckled seagulls, the old man, listening to his radio on the torn white couch. Two, pizza, crust, onions, pepperoni, sausage, cheese. It took me a while to actually know and love pizza, as all Italian food seems malleable and finite. Pizza wobbling on my hand seems finite. A room full of nouns. A squeak of noise, the noise nouns make. The room full of fears, the tears dry to run to the rain for silence. From the noise nouns make. Once upon a day, the rebirth of take and give, the reasons we forgot to see more to reason for the season of reason, we yearn and pine. For away there is noise, the noise nouns make. Noise and nouns and nonsense the sounds. We listen and search the heavens. The moon and the clouds penetrate the dark sky. I will ask why and what we listen to. Well, the noise that nouns make. Nouns fall from my loins like flowers. A metaphor, the king asks his men for more than heaven. This house of images belongs to someone else. Two more poems. One, turn up your heart, the moon is full. Two, the morn of the moon is in mourning. Another poem. I'm like a boat snoring at the mooring. Poema appassionata. Set this house on fire. My thrust sets the world on fire. I sometimes think I am at the top of high achievement and excruciating responses. high excitement and high achievement. Only Henry James, history is dark. Another poem, the icy trees in North Beach I cannot reach, for I'm just a small boy that has yet to be obeyed. On the eve of a reading, there are people over there, as I lose my mind to a pronoun, at the beach. The sun sets as though a child had drawn it, rays like a crayon, glimmer to the sand, the waves squeal and giggle, undulate underneath a passive surfer on top of days and dazes. The sun sings a song to the soft wet sand, I'm almost afraid to run to the water and get wet up to my ankles. Sonnet at Starbucks. The day presses onward, my lips concentrate on the blaring trombones and conga drums that remind me of far-off ecstasy and dancers. Yes, the pulse of dancers that move and sway, that carry on with the day's tedium and romance. Goals and visions, a mad pulse that cannot cease if the sky had stopped being blue and gray. If sirens stopped blaring and making all the noise to end all noises, the noise that penetrates all pleasure and silence, the streets are a serene jungle that jangles all, that jingles and jangles, that jangles the jungle. Away, atop the world, the debris is a rubble of cinders and the adjustments of it all. You are reborn a thousand times, ball and chain, struggle with night and stubble to show for it all. Grub and make, double or nothing, that's the way it is, the gall, the nerve, you wind up meaning nothing. Stall around, that's the best you couldn't do, a bubble I try to burst and hope it will not stop. And start, that's how it goes along. Merry men learn from their mistakes, they stop then go, so routine faults are a lot like that. Nary a hair, that's what I wonder at. I try by not putting my head, trying to put my head in the sand. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. And now I'm in the zone of the mic zone. Alright, I'm just going to say a couple of things before we begin, because I want to say a couple of things before we begin, so I will say a couple of things before I begin. One is that I have a value of generosity. I like people who are generous, and I try to be generous as much as I can. Sometimes I'm really stingy, but I like being generous. And one of the things that happens here is people are very generous with their time. When they come up here on the mic, a lot of times people go short, and it allows other people to go long, and then a little bit, you know, you keep it really real and honest, and it helps. And I really appreciate everybody who is staying with everything and listening. I love it. So there was something else I was going to say at the camera, Rick. So I just titled this poem now. I don't know what I was going to say. I wanted to not read this before Clara came on. Because the contrast might be, you know, unfortunate. So, Martin Joseph is the volunteer. He's going to get to clean your palate. What? You'll see. This is as Don Brennan would say it. Now, if you know Don Brennan, you know what's coming. Who rose from their ruins to ruin us all? Who would rule this world in everything but name, and who want that old gang of time to wear their colors, black and red and white? They steal a march on many fronts, the economic, their IMF, World Bank, and Euro buy and sell people. They design all the investments to be invested in their investments, and they laugh all the way to their banks. On the political, we know better to ask, are you independent of big money? Because we know the answer.
on the informational, which is now disinformation, deceit, riddled with secrets wrapped in enigmatic duplicitous codes, presented in a crafted light show of shadow, directing the mindless minions whose muted mouths deafen everyone's ears with their din. On the religious, now zombie-ridden cults willing to kill or be killed, and we consume the frankenfood, for God's sakes, which even has the isolated, the bloated bodies of consumers starving. On the medical, with cures that do not research into breeding plagues, and there's been various addictive substances offered most freely for everyone to buy. They've incorporated a vast, devouring monster. It feeds off every conceivable thing. And now they consume and befoul the water and the air. They compete to measure and count or discount us as they may have it. They are murderous. In the tens of millions a year, the world over, they are everyone who is anyone telling us anything about anything and everywhere and everybody and everything. About what's going on and why, and we cannot help but listen to no. They don't need ovens these days. They're far too slow, too much of a show, and costly. And now there's just too darn many. After all, it's not just the Jew anymore. Never was. Their aim has not changed, not a whit's worth. You know what I mean. And they learn. Their new approach gets the news, all the views, has the hits, likes, and all that jazz. They read the shock doctrine, and chaos works for them like nobody's business. It's simple. No matter how you shred a nation, it's the shredding that's the thing. It keeps the underbulk under with poverty and more murderous murders. It's a way as easy as American pie. Why anyone who's anyone isn't on the bandwagon, and how? And they're getting better and better at dividing and conquering. They can reduce and recycle and reuse anyone. That's the ticket. Play both ends against the middle. Pull on both sides of the rope, a dope. This is postmodern political science, and we are useless against this enemy. Even knowing the show for what it is, we, blessed by the muse, watch, and I, for one, feel cursed to live in such a time when no one looks at your vision, no one reads what you write, no one listens to you speak. They say the odds don't matter anymore. So many illusionists just dive into excess as if to say, well, if I can live well even in this kind of time, why shouldn't I? I mean, live life to the fullest. And perhaps this makes some kind of sense, and perhaps if enough wine is applied along that way. We count on this, though. They'll continue. So chaos, corrupt states, religions, charities, bend science, and more. We live in a world of ruins that lies hidden in broad daylight before our open eyes. It is a world of slaves we never see, though we look in the mirror every day. We are sold to the highest bidder. It is a world of rulers living off their one big lie. Their lie that everything has a price tag, anything can be put on the block, and that nothing is beyond their reach. So there's your news. Let's Don Brennan for you. That channel done. So I apologize for that. And now Martin's going to come up here and, like I said, clear the etherical palates. And then we'll have Clara come up here and lift us into the stratospheric wonders of passionate poetry. Martin?
Give him a round as he comes up here.
Good evening, Sacred Grass.
Good evening, Mr. Martin Marshall. Martin Joseph, sorry.
I still forget everything.
Who let you in here?
I keep on.
For 25 years, I played chess with a cab driver named Louis. He passed away, and I wrote this for him. It's called Louis and the Aliens. Nothing bothered Louis except the aliens. He could not quite see what they looked like, but he knew they were there. They were the eerie lights over Brisbane, Things not having to do with the San Francisco airport. Things not coming from the swamp marsh of decaying landfill. Things coming from some forgotten place, some empty land next to the highway. He felt them coming, landing on the hill opposite his house. The hill, once barren but marked for condo villages. Perhaps the developers and the aliens were acquainted. Perhaps the aliens were just those who were alien to Louis. For the last three decades, he fought his own battles. The crust had always been there. He played the ogre to drive away the superficial. He played the tough guy to ward off all except those with X-ray vision. There was never an acknowledgement because his thinking was that if you needed an acknowledgement, it wasn't real. So too it is. In the land between numbers and logic, in the place where cards and chess pieces mingle with downtown traffic, bags of luggage, and the lines of cabs at the airport. He stood up to Gavin Newsom like Don Quixote, raised his middle finger and told him to windmill this. The downtown powers did what they wanted to anyway over the objections of Louis. Developers moved on Brisbane, lining another natural hill with condos. Louis stood for election after all these years, and although everyone agreed it was hopeless from the beginning, he almost pulled it off. Under the basket, he was a pair of flying elbows until his back gave out, and those days were gone. Perhaps only a few knew that this is the man who put the word rigoball into Webster's dictionary. It's rigoball, said Louis, watching the evening news. Rigoball, said Louis, down at the taxi commission. Up at City Hall, he said, all they play is rigoball. Down at the airport, too. Eventually, they knew someone would begin to believe them. That's why they sent the aliens down, first to scare him, second to scare him, and then on a more serious mission. He knew they were coming. He knew there was nothing he could do. He knew that only those with X-ray vision would know the truth, and we do. We pass one another in the hallway, and in quiet remembrance of the great Looster, we mutter under our breaths, rigoball.
All right.
This brings us to the feature of the evening, unless I miss my guess, and I very rarely miss my guess because it's my guess, and I can decide whether I missed it. Sorry about that. Rigoball. Now I have to talk about that. But let me introduce the feature, just say a couple of words. This person is a really good poet. There's a lot of people here because of that reason, and it's recognized far and wide. A really good sense of the word and a passion for it, and she really is exacting. I mean, she will work at something and work at something that's right, and then it gets read. You know, so she won't give you this secondhand stuff or stuff like off that. She's very, very well read, intelligent, and wonderful. Clara Sue, come on up. Give her a nice Clara.
Jack Foley, ladies and gentlemen, I didn't know, I thought they had changed.
How are you?
Oh, sorry.
How are you?
Not bad,
my old
man. Thank you.
You look good.
Thank you very much for being here. And I'm very happy to share my new book of poems.
Louder.
Please. The First to Escape. And I have to acknowledge Jack Foley because he's my mentor since 2011. And many of you who know me for a long time recognize there's a change in my poetry. And so this book has a lot of those changes in there. It has some old poems, but it has mostly the poems that I started writing after Jack became my mentor. So this book is dedicated to Jack. And I'm going to read two poems tonight. And these are long poems. So it's going to be a little bit over the 20 minutes. It's just
We'll be here for the next couple of days.
I have appointments on Tuesday.
The first poem that one thing that Jack had started me doing is to write in multiple voices so that the poems is not read by one person, can be read by two people, and I've poems that can be read for three people, and Adele had been reading some of those poems that I've written for three people. So one of these days I'm gonna do one of those poems here. But tonight I'm gonna present two. And this first one I wrote this year, actually, my father was in the hospital multiple times because of a hip fracture. And while he was in the hospital, I worked on the Tao Te Ching, and I translated the whole Tao Te Ching in 2 months.
Wow.
It's crazy, but it's something that I think it helped me get through the very difficult time. So in this book, I included the first 10 passages of the Tao Te Ching with a little bit of my own poems in there. And so I titled it, Like Water, Tao Te Ching and Complications.
Tao.
To speak it is not the extraordinary Tao.
Name.
To name it is not the extraordinary name.
Absence is the beginning of heaven and earth.
Presence is the mother of 10,000 things.
Therefore be absent so as to behold the wonder of Tao.
Be present so as to behold the limitation of things.
These two emerge together with different names.
And together they are mysterious.
Mystery upon mystery.
The door to all wonders.
Is it heaviness?
Lightness.
Already it is. Euphoric, the mouth.
Euphoric, the nipples.
Euphoric, the penis.
Liquid exchange.
Hunger. All under heaven. Know what beauty is.
That is ugliness.
All know what good is.
Evil.
Absence and presence are born together.
Hardship and ease complete each other.
Long and short are shaped together.
High and low lean on each other.
Music and sound harmonize together.
Front and back follow each other.
Therefore the sage does things that are absent, teaches without speaking.
From nothing.
Does not judge the workings of 10,000 things. Produces but does not own.
Still.
Services without pride. Does not rest in accomplishment.
Stoic.
The one who does not rest in accomplishment shall never cease.
Trickle of sound. Distill. Distill. From one thread. Link. Extract. Move. Extend. Retract. Store.
By not esteeming the worthy, the mass will not engage in rivalry.
By not valuing goods that are difficult to come by, the mass will not steal.
By not displaying desirables, the mass's heart will not be confused.
Therefore, it is how the sage rules. Humble the heart.
Fortify the stomach.
Weaken ambition.
Strengthen the bone.
Let the mass be absent from shrewdness and desire.
So that even the clever ones won't dare to act.
Act. Without acting.
I'm always tutored.
Many eyes sees many things.
Many things does many eyes see.
It sees.
It likes.
It wants.
It keeps.
Many eyes keeps many things.
Many eyes has a headache for having so many things.
It doesn't know where to put this.
It doesn't know where to put that.
It doesn't know where.
It doesn't know.
Many eyes has a headache.
It doesn't want.
Many eyes closes one eye.
Many eyes closes two.
Many eyes keeps closing his eyes until only one is open.
Its headache is gone.
Many eyes keeps only one eye open.
The Tao rushes.
And yet to use it, it never overflows.
An abyss.
Like the ancestor of 10,000 things.
Blunts what is sharp.
Untangles what is quarrelsome.
Blends what is bright.
Companion to what is dust.
Oh, deep as death, but it exists.
I don't know whose offspring it is. before the appearance of the Yellow Emperor.
The time when the head flew out of the body, not caring about severed ties.
Or plunging into icy water.
Or bouncing out of the sphere.
The time when no one was able to catch it, or even got a glimpse of its properties.
Everyone dismissed it as a flying saucer.
Everyone had a head on the body.
Everyone except one.
Body without a head.
Doing. Heaven and earth are merciless. They let all things live and die. The sages are merciless. They treat the mass like straw dogs. The space between heaven and earth, isn't it like a bellows? Empty, but does not collapse. Use it, and more comes out. Excessive words debilitate. Better to guard the center.
What? It's time to get up? Time to get dressed, have breakfast, brush teeth? It's time to go? What? You can't wait? I'm dragging my feet? I'm too slow? I have no drive? What? You don't like my attitude? I'm pretending just to aggravate you? I'm making you mad? What did you say to me last night? Did I do my homework? Did I? It's too late now. Too late? What? You're leaving now? What do I do then? You don't care?
The valley spirit does not die. It is called the mysterious female. The opening of the mysterious female is the root of heaven and earth. Softly, gently, it exists. Use it without effort.
First rose, long stem, romance of your lips. Testing, tasting, pink turns crimson. Stem shivers, petals scatter, one between my eyes, two on my breast, and the rest, like all others, slip casually to the floor.
Heaven is eternal.
Earth is everlasting.
They last forever because they are not nurtured in order to survive. Therefore, they are everlasting.
The sage puts his body in the back.
And becomes the one in front.
Puts his body on the outside.
And is able to preserve it.
Isn't it because of his selflessness that he may realize the self?
At a bustling street corner, an old nun touches the face of a young soldier, asks,
"What is your wish?"
He replies, "I want to make love."
Highest good is like water. Water benefits all things but does not compete.
It lies in the lowest place, which all men disdain.
Therefore, it is close to the Tao.
Dwell in goodness with a heart good and deep.
Do good to others.
Speak in good faith.
Govern with good system.
Perform with good capability.
Act in good time.
If only man does not compete, there will be no strife.
Akil is like illy. Ak illy illy kak. Ye eat. Like egret, 1 foot illy illy the water flows. Ak, it calls. Ak, ak.
E,
no ill.
Is like
ill. Always perfect.
Illy. Illy,
sky,
king,
the
king,
cloud,
eat,
water,
like
egret, the air,
1 foot, illy, illy, the water flows, it calls,
like
ill, like all is perfect,
like
the sky, the cloud,
a
the water,
being
the air, as if all ills are killed, illily, as if
it
is, like,
ickle,
Kyle, is tickle in Norwegian, a figure being tickled, illy, illy. The egret wades, illy, as if Ichil is like holding onto something that is overflowing.
It is better to stop.
Fitting a short beam on the roof.
It won't last long.
A hall filled with gold and jade cannot be guarded.
Riches and honors breed arrogance, causing one's own downfall. Withdraw when work is done.
The way of heaven. Knife cannot cut water. Water cannot separate land. Land cannot divide man.
Blink.
And all is not well again.
Body and soul embrace.
Can they not be separated?
The vital breath is soft.
Can it be like that of an infant?
The mysterious vision is cleansed.
Can it be without blemish?
Love the country, govern the people.
Can it be done without strategy?
The gate of heaven opens.
Can it be without the female?
Having enlightenment in four directions.
Can it be from ignorance?
Grow and domesticate. Propagate without claim. Service without pride. Lead without supremacy. This is called the mysterious virtue. The second piece that we're doing, it's a piece that I wrote a couple years ago. I've been taking care of my dad, who is right now 93 years old, for the past 5 years. And he started developing dementia about 3 years ago. And when my sister came to visit from Australia, I was telling him all the things that has changed with him and the caretaking that I've been doing. And I just laughed. I said, this is like a madhouse. This is like the Fantasia, the cartoon Fantasia in Disney. And this apprentice is trying to, clean up and do all the things, and the sorceress is, going wild with, whatever magic that he was doing. And so I titled this poem Madhouse, Fantasia, and Fugue, and it is about taking care of my dad. You will hear different voices, some of them mine, some of them his various caretakers. There's a Chinese man who speak only a Southern Chinese dialect. And then there's a little Palestinian young man who's also helping out. So all kinds of people.
I'm Clara's father. It's time to ask him.
And Jeff will read the father's lines.
Okay.
Madhouse, Fantasia, and Fugue.
Fantasia. Knowledge knows no lynch.
Now, the wizard cannot tell night from day. He asks his apprentice,
what should I do?
His wand, tiny like the sprout of a lily's bulb, liquid gold freely discharging. They try to catch each drop with a tubular vessel without much success.
It's all your fault,
cries the wizard. His names are many. The angel comes in the form of a farmer, bad teeth, slim and muscular. He has endured turbulent times. Knowing the wizard's trouble, the angel says, and the wizard scowls.
I don't know what you're talking about. You don't speak my language. Be gone.
But the angel folds his wings over the wizard's ears and gently repeats the words, knowing that he is deaf.
Oh, my daughter, you travel from the underside of the earth to be near me. I call to you, hello, hello, and you pat my back and say, accept your fate. I'm embarrassed. I'm fearful. I want to tell you things, but I can't. I'm confused by my own magic.
She drifts in and out of the wizard's sight, bringing him baskets of fruits and sweets. She has just made love inside a secret cavern, with wild things howling at the entrance. Her lover hummed an ancient tune, ethereal, haunting. She is his daughter and lover. She is his mother. He crouches on the throne while she trims his claws. She shaves his head. There is no need for furnishing.
2 minutes is not sufficient. It must be 3. 5 is too much, and all will be burned. Move!
Commands the wizard.
The lights are going out.
The elixir of sleep is stirred and drunk. The clock is meaningless, as no one keeps time.
Fugue. Turn on the light. It's dark here. I'm sick, and you don't even know it.
Don't even know.
Day and night have lost their cloaks. Naked they are. Sexless.
It's 3 in the morning. It's dark here. Go back to sleep.
White mice circling around the ceiling lamp. Turn on the light.
Turn on the light.
Dark here.
Dark here.
There's no turning, telling which one is which. My daughter, I'm sick. What should I do?
Lie down, back to bed. It's what you must do. Lie down in darkness, the light.
It's early. It's late. I'm hungry. I'm not.
I'm not hungry. I'm...
Many things are yet to be done, and you don't even know.
Rock-a-bye, baby, on the treetop, when the wind blows.
You don't even know.
Ma-san, Zou-san, 你好吗?
People coming and going, faces, noise, night, day, darkness, light. Turn on the light and you'll know and you'll see that I'm sick.
你唔好自己起身行啊，等我嚟帮你，唔系一针又跌倒。
King Lear, the heath is full of ghosts. Cello and piano
entwines,
bemoans.
A young man's laughter rings fearless in the open space.
Soon they too will disappear. It's dark here, and you don't even know it.
Hey, hey, wake up, wake up. 老人家要多喝点汤水，马上喝多点汤水。
So much to do, so little time. Are you sure everything is secured? I'm not sure I'm sick. I'm in the dark.
Don't even know. He told me to stay back, said no, 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 and then he fell.
The furniture, move it from one room to another, preserve it. Calligraphies all over the floor, walls, ceilings. Turn on the light. She is writing me a message. There, she's impatient. Can't you see it's dark here? Look how she shakes the mailbox.
Turn on the light.
You don't see. Don't know.
My father was born on 12th night.
He woke at 3 in the morning.
My father loved music.
He couldn't go back to sleep.
My father learned to build a piano.
He was groggy and nervous.
My father opened a factory in Hong Kong.
He waited for his friends to arrive.
My father sold his pianos all over the world.
He smiled when his old quartet showed up.
My father immigrated to America.
He drank chickpea soup and ate barbecue chicken.
My father built a world music shop in San Francisco.
He sang happy birthday with them.
My father suffered a stroke while playing the cello.
He blew out all the candles.
My father had to retire.
He ate his chocolate cake.
My father turned 90 on 12th night.
He clapped his hands and said, thank you.
Ma-san.
Don't know it. Don't see.
等我来帮你.
Who are you? Don't remember. Who am I? Ha! You don't even know it.